enjoy podcasts, lady dudes. You're about to enjoy a podcast from the Lowtree Studios Podcast Network. If you want more great podcasts, dudes and lady dudes and dudes and other peoples, go to LowtreeStudios.com. It's the studios. Okay. Goodbye.
Wreck my podcast.
Grab your chainsaw, hack off your hand, and get ready to say groovy, because we are going on the wild ride with Bruce Campbell, known as Evil Dead 2. Find out if this wrecks our Halloween.
Wreck my podcast.
Hello. With the Patreon money we have received, the Wreck My Podcast was able to build a sentient robot to help out with disclaimers. How cool is that? Before we begin the episode, my overlords have instructed me to let our listeners know that they are still working on getting video and audio worked out, and that this episode has some problems. Although I am near perfect, not all technology is as well designed as me, so we apologize for any audio problems that exist in this episode. But they say the content is good. I wouldn't know because they haven't installed my humor bolt yet. Boobs.
Welcome to the Wreck My Podcast, where this week we decided to cover The Evil Dead 2 because one of our patrons asked us to do The Evil Dead, and we thought, you know what, screw you, we're doing The Evil Dead 2 because Cam wanted to do Evil Dead 2.
Yeah, I wanted to double it.
Double it. So I'm here with my guest. His nickname in high school was Chainsaw Hand. It's Cam.
Groovy.
Yeah, he's only been mistaken for a deadite 3 times in his life. It's Craigor.
There's someone in my fruit cellar.
He'll blow your butts to kingdom come. It's Joe.
I love Too Evil, Too Dead.
And I'm your host, Jordan. I've swallowed an eyeball or two in my time. Okay, guys, so first off, if
but the question is, did you spit it out?
I did not. No, I wanted all the protein. Yeah, I'm not a quitter at all. I wanted all the protein and vitamins. If Cam sounds a little different, it's because Cam's mic's not working this week. But we have.
I'm just on the onboard mic. We're good. There we go. Yeah, that was all of us.
But we wanted Cam back because, let's be honest, the past 3 weeks, the fans have been clamoring to have the fan favorite, Cameron Molador, back on the podcast.
I'm back. I'm here. I'm queer. Get used to it.
There you go.
All of those are factual.
Does that work?
Yeah. I know.
Does that work in Tennessee for you saying that?
No. But in Tennessee, I've actually been like really, really stoked because I've seen actually way more pride flags than I expected. And then I've also seen more.
Like
we all
three?
Know how. Yeah, actually 3.
They're all in Cam's front yard.
But you know, we all know that I'm like very, very liberal, and I have seen more Trump flags in Santa Clarita and Simi Valley than in Knoxville. So,
oh, wow,
this place is really, really like a progressive college town for sure.
Nice. So that's perfect for you then. You're in the one blue center that is Tennessee. Yeah. So it's a good place to live.
Also, Jordan, quick question. Do you have the same issue too? Because we all know what California is like, especially Southern California. But when you go out to eat, vegetables aren't sides or part of a dish.
No, not here, because where I live in Texas is very
health conscious.
Well, not even health conscious. The area I live, like the Dallas DFW area, they're very, I don't know how to put it. They're very California-esque in the sense that they have a lot of vegan restaurants, a lot of vegan options. They're very, very like leftist forward type ideal out in this area. So you'll get your like spots, like all the barbecue spots are pretty much no vegetables or anything, but any other restaurant you go to is good.
So here, every single restaurant we go to, the sides are either French fries, coleslaw is considered a side salad here.
Side salad?
And
nice.
And it's just, they're like, here, do you want a bowl of coleslaw? Side salad. I'm like, gross, dude.
If it has mayonnaise, you can't consider it a salad.
Right, but every salad here has mayonnaise.
Oh, jeez.
And then And then the only other available, one available vegetable, I was like, guys, is there a vegetable? Like, I was getting a steak and I had mashed potatoes and I didn't want another carb. So I was just like, vegetables, please. And I was like, do you have steamed broccoli and carrots or whatever? What? And they went, oh, we have green beans. They're cooked in bacon fat with cream.
Yeah, that doesn't help. That doesn't help at all.
No, so that's
I think you should have asked before you put those green beans in bacon fat and lard or whatever. Can you just grab a few and throw them in some boiling water and throw some salt on it and I'll be happy?
I'll eat them raw. Like, dude, like I don't. When I go to the grocery store, all I do is buy vegetables now. My fridge is just vegetables because I know if I go out to eat or anything, all I'm getting is 6 pounds of the best pulled pork I've ever eaten and a pound of the best mashed potatoes I've ever eaten and nothing else.
Well, here's a question. I saw
I
that you posted
the problem
you had.
In that.
Well, you will after about 2 or 3 years. But yeah. Cam, I have a question. You said you tried Mexican food there and it was awful. Which is there's got to be a good Mexican place around because the Mexican food here is actually not too bad.
You have Tex-Mex. That's way different.
Yeah, and Jordan, think about how close you are to the border compared to me.
That's true. And it's not just Tex-Mex out here. I found some Mexican food that's like California Mexican, like Baja Mexican food.
Like
out
real
here,
Mexican food?
Real Mexican food. There's a place called Petra's out here that's almost identical to La Cocina.
Okay, so well, that's kind of cool. I looked everywhere, and I looked at every single menu. There's a place called Soccer Taco here, which it was like traditional Mexican food. And I looked at it, I was like, you can't be traditional if you just say two things Mexican people like, soccer and taco. It doesn't make it traditional. And then, I looked at the menu, hot garbage. I looked at a couple other places. There's a place out here which is called Pilonchos, which is neither... Ooh. Any phrase in Mexico nor a Mexican last name, so I don't know what they're doing. And I looked garbage. And so I ordered from a place that looked like it just had a regular standard burrito. Like it just said burrito, select your meat, right? So I picked shredded chicken because I was like, I just kind of want chicken tonight. I got refried beans and like their Mexican cheese blend, and I added pico de gallo. That's all I did in the thing. And it gets delivered. I ordered guacamole and chips and salsa. Chips, salsa, totally okay, right? Like, it tasted kind of just like I opened up a bag of Tostitos and, like, a jar of paste, right? Like, it wasn't great. And then I opened up my guacamole. I almost cussed, but that's not the show we cuss on.
This is not the one, no.
No. And this is not the way. My guacamole was 4 avocados, which is generous, but just giant cubes with, like, 1 cherry tomato. And... Oh, did you not see the video, Joe?
I don't think so.
I saw the video.
Oh, man. Okay, I'll send it to the group chat because...
Oh, I saw that. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, what I'm about to tell you is the grossest thing in the history of bastardized Mexican food ever. I ate my burrito. Bless you. He's allergic to it, too, like I was. I opened up the thing, and I took the lid off. It was like one of those like things that you get your like to-go food in or whatever, and I took the lid off. And I had a burrito that was like the size of a human thigh, right? But it was covered in milk.
Ew.
There was like 3/4 cup of just whole milk poured over it. It wasn't sour cream because I tasted it. It wasn't any kind of like queso, like a white queso. Wasn't that. It was liquid milk poured on a burrito. And that's apparently what people in Tennessee think Mexicans do.
Yeah, of course. I mean, you throw some milk on it. It's good for your skeletal health.
I don't understand that.
Milk is good for your overall skeletal health.
Yeah.
Your overall skeletal health.
It's high in calcium.
Yeah, high in calcium. All right, so now that we're about 10 minutes into this podcast and we barely talked about Evil Dead, let's show the trailer for Evil Dead 2. Yes, Craiger, I see you have a question. What's up, Craiger?
Was your joke funny enough?
Well, first of all, I'm going to be really strategic with when I talk because... It's really laggy on my end. Like I talk and I have to wait like,
oh, yeah.
Okay, then you hear me. So I was just going to say today I went and had coffee with patron of the show, Marissa Cola. And
is she so hot?
I bought from her, which is her and her mom's business, little side business. Yes. Yes. So I bought that. What they do is called Brew and Bougie. We'll put it in the show notes for their Instagram. You can buy, they take cool beer cans and they put candles in them. So if you see, I bought the Dunkaroos one.
Whoa, that's awesome, man.
What, you're actually trying it?
Yeah, so yeah, it's a candle. It's really cool.
Nice.
No, it's just a candle.
No, well,
not the beer. He didn't get to drink the beer.
Yeah, it's just a candle. Yeah. I think it's drinking.
You're a candle.
Yeah, so it's cool. And also, Jordan will be adding will be a tier to our Patreon. You can, I will take you out for coffee as one of our
tiers. Yeah, Craig or date. We're taking Cam off the Patreon tier for a date because he's taken, and now Craig is going up for a lot less.
For $2, you can take Craig out on because a coffee date.
It's only coffee.
What?
Yeah. All right, guys. Let's get into this trailer real quick. Yeah, no. Joe got food brought to him, but not us. So we're going to do the trailer real quick here. But if you haven't yet, go subscribe to our YouTube channel where you could actually see this trailer if you don't want to just listen to what I assume is going to be a lot of weird burps and belches and ba-ba-ba-ba-bas and Bruce Campbell saying groovy. So here we go. Let's talk about or let's see this trailer.
Bacon.
Four years ago, in this quiet forest, in this cozy cabin, something happened. Something so frightening. Something so deadly. Something so evil. We prayed it would never happen again. Now, from the creator of Evil Dead comes Evil Dead 2. Dawn.
All right, guys, we're back from that trailer. I got a question for you. We're going to start with Craig and we're going to move down the line. Craig, then Cam, then Joe. Craig, have you seen this movie before? And if you have, when was the last time you've seen it?
No, I have not.
There you go. So this was your first time seeing it. Cam, what about you?
Yeah, this is probably my favorite iteration of all of the Evil Dead movies. I like it because it's absolutely insane. It like makes zero sense. It's weird claymation for so much of it. And it's just Bruce Campbell who took like 6 tabs of acid and the director took double that. And then they were like, all right, let's make a movie. Like, this movie makes no sense. And I think I saw it. The last time I saw it was when my friend Chase in high school, who used to collect laser discs, had it on limited edition, blood red edition.
Ooh,
Evil Dead 2.
That's
laser
cool.
Disc. Yeah. So we watched it on Laserdisc, and I was like, I don't know, maybe 17. And it was incredible. So I loved watching it again. It's like so many memories for me.
Oh, of course. And then Joe, how about you?
I've never seen this one, but I've seen the first one. I like the first one, except for one scene in it. But this one wasn't bad. It's, you know, I like the stop motion aspect of it. I don't know if I like the comedy aspect of this movie, but other than that, not bad.
Well, I'm with Joe here on the watching order. I've seen The Evil Dead before. I've never seen any of the other movies. So this was my first time seeing The Evil Dead 2. I kind of want to see Army of Darkness now just to be the completionist in me wants to watch all three of them and just say, hey, I've seen them. Now, I have a feeling, because with what Joe just said about this, I have a feeling this episode is mostly going to be Cam trying to convince the three of us why we should like this movie.
Absolutely.
Because,
100%.
Yeah. Because I did not like this one nearly as much as I liked The Evil Dead.
Like, not at all?
Not really at all. I thought most of it was stupid. I thought the comedy was flat, and I also thought it was so hokey that I just couldn't get into it. Here's what I have to say. The first movie was scary despite its low budget. This one just looked like a sci-fi TV movie that I didn't want to sit through.
I 100% agree with that.
So that's my problem with it. And here's the thing. I get it. I get that it's supposed to be kind of making fun of its original self. It's kind of a remake, kind of a sequel, all balled up in one. And I do have a theory we're going to talk about at the end of this episode that actually makes me a little bit more acceptable that it goes kind of comedic and crazy as you move along in the series of the trilogy. Or I guess we could just talk about it now. So The Evil Dead 1 is a very serious horror film.
Yeah.
The Evil Dead 2 is a little bit dark humor, but still a horror film. And from what I know of Army of Darkness, is it's just a straight, crazy comedy, slapstick,
insane.
Monty Python type.
It's a slapstick horror because it's still hyperviolent.
Yes. So what the theory says here, and let me read it for you. There's an in-universe reason as to why the movies get more and more crazy and comedic as they go on. Ash begins to lose his sanity and starts to see the Deadites as cartoonish and funny as his grip on reality gets looser. That's why he becomes less afraid of them as the movie trilogy progresses. By Army of Darkness, the Deadites become bumbling and stupid because Ash no longer fears them, and the fear is what they need to thrive. No one is supposed to make it through that first night. The Deadites are always supposed to kill them, so once they do, the fact that they start losing their sanity makes the Deadites less and less scary, and they're able to fight against them then. So this movie is the progression of Ash just losing his mind.
That theory comes into actuality at the exact same scene where everything starts laughing like that lamp, and my favorite scene when the deer starts giggling. I love that weird laughing deer. That happens, and he, by showing him laughing with them, shows that he is getting a lot more numb to the sinister energy of that place. And
yeah,
that is amazing. Was it running enough? Ashley, we're podcasting!
Yeah, Ashley, get out of here!
Ashley, we're podcasting, god...
We're in the middle of podcasting, Ashley. Come on.
Also, Ashley, none of them liked Evil Dead 2 except for me.
Ashley's the reason we watched this movie. She's the patron I said asked to do the Evil Dead, and we said, nah, we're doing Evil Dead 2.
I didn't ask for Evil Dead 2. I asked for the first one and the remake. God.
Well, you know what? You know what?
I would have rather done that.
You can't always get what you want. Yeah, we're teaching you a lesson that you can't always get what you want, Ashley, even when you pay for it.
But if you try sometimes,
I was
going
to up it to $15, but now I'm not.
Oh, no. Dang. So here's the reason I didn't do what Ashley wanted. Ashley said she wanted to do the Evil Dead versus the Evil Dead remake from 2013. I didn't want to watch the Evil Dead remake because I'm scared it will be too violent for me. Because with 2013 prosthetics and CGI, I don't know if I can handle that.
Very grateful that I didn't be sweaty in my in Tennessee by myself.
Hey, you know what, though? Cam, you said nobody else likes Evil Dead 2 but us.
Yeah.
It's got a 95% on Rotten Tomatoes, so...
Because it's amazing!
Way to ruin my segment, Ashley.
It's amazing. It's an amazing movie. It's an amazing, amazing movie because it's ridiculously great.
When I found out this had a 95% critic, I opened my door and I yelled out to Madison, I've lost all faith in Rotten Tomatoes scores.
I just want to like acknowledge that I typically fall exactly in line with the critic score, and you guys all typically fall in line with the audience score every time.
Well,
for every movie.
The audience score is only 89%. That's still really high.
Oh, only a B plus? That's great.
Yeah. I mean, that's what I'm saying.
It's the critic.
It's still very high of a percentage. So
Where
this movie
Frigger?
People love.
It's fantastic because it's so weird. That's why, because there's no other horror movie this stupid and weird.
I mean, there are some horror movies this stupid and weird. Mm-hmm. We just don't watch them because they're called, like, Eight-Legged Freaks and stuff like
that. No, Eight-Legged Freaks isn't even this stupid and weird. Eight-Legged Freaks is dumb. Stupid and weird is this.
That's true. Well, we haven't watched Velociraptor, or not Velocipaster.
Yeah. Not on the cast, but I've watched it.
Yeah.
What did I almost
Oh, you've watched it?
I have, like, the Axe Murders of Velisca or whatever on right now, but I almost put on It Came from the Desert, which is supposed to be, I think, kind of like an Eight-Legged Freaks. So
sick.
Oh, you know what? You know what other movie is dumb like this is Rubber.
Mm. Oh, Rubber is one of my all-time favorite movies.
Yeah, that movie is very weird.
We sat and watched Killer Pinata. Weird. Nothing can beat that movie.
Killer Pinata was
Killer Pinata.
Rubber that was one of Joe's other animal. Yeah,
Rubber. Rubber is one of Joe's least favorite words.
What in the world are you even talking about?
Yeah, it's because he has a latex allergy. That's why. So right.
It's all about the lambskin.
Yeah, I'm reading through my notes here, and one question I had a few questions here.
Yeah,
one. When he gets the paper in the fruit cellar and it's all wet and then he like throws it up to the girl, it literally doesn't go like paper goes. Like he throws it up like it's a brick or something. Like if it was paper, it would have like floated around.
Not if
like,
it's wet.
No, I don't. Even paper. If it's wet. Oh my God. No, that wasn't the evil paper. That was the paper that helped them.
No, but it was possessed by the evil paper. It takes over everything over there.
It was still written in sheep's blood, bro.
That's true. It still was written in sheep's blood. Also, how is Ash alive after everything he went through? Wouldn't he have been bled out by some point in this movie?
After he chainsawed off his own hand?
Yeah, after he chainsaws off his hand, and then after he's, like, beaten up a million times and possessed a million times, I think he would be dead before this movie was over.
No, he's just really resilient, man. Like, and he's already been possessed by this demon, so maybe he's channeling this demon's, like, hyper affluent energy, and he's just like, yo, you know what, I'm half demon, half man. It's kind of like Weird Blade, and he's like going to Weird Blade all the way through the Evil Dead series.
I like when he gets the chainsaw hand in this one, because all I was thinking was in Child's Play 2 when the Chucky doll gets his hand chopped off and then he shoves the knife in his stub. He's got the knife hand. Yeah. I'm like, this is great. This is so good.
Have you seen Ash versus the Evil Dead?
Ooh, so good.
Yeah, super good.
We were just Cam and I were talking about that before the podcast. I saw the first episode and I really liked it. I really want to go back and watch. I think there's 3 seasons of it.
Yeah, unfortunately,
it got a fun time.
It got canceled, but it was really good. I enjoyed it a lot.
I'm sure all of our listeners are going to love the fact that Joe is off mic and that we can hear plates being clanked around. So
yeah, just Ashley eating off of plates.
Just Ashley eating, talking. That's all it is.
It's 1:00. It's breakfast.
I'm comfortable talking right because it's so Craig's delayed.
Yeah, Craig's being real quiet on this one. So I have a question. We're going to start with Craig. Craig, did this wreck your Halloween?
No, it did not wreck
my
Halloween.
Are you really?
Halloween.
Come on.
It, no, I'm being serious. It didn't wreck it. It was so funny. Well, this is going to be terrible because we're going to do this back and you're going to sync all of us up and it's going to be just terrible. Anyways, so I mean, I've kind of know about this franchise, but I've never seen it before. I mean, I was kind of watching it just like, this is like really dumb, but like it wasn't as bad as Parents, which no movie is. So I mean, it was funny, you know. I kind of like laughed at a few parts and a couple other parts. I'm like, this looks like a child made this, like in the 80s. Like, what the hell's going on here? But you know, it didn't ruin anything. It just was. It was like you're stubbing your toe, but like only mildly. Like, oh, that sucks.
So it was slightly painful for Craig, but not painful enough that it would wreck anything. Cam, what do you think? Did this wreck your Halloween? I think I know your answer.
No, this made my Halloween. This is the best way for me to springboard my Halloween and to go from this immediately into Hocus Pocus like I did. It was a great start.
Oh nice.
You watched Hocus Pocus early because we're covering Hocus Pocus for the end of the month. on this podcast.
I don't know anything about anything, man.
Yeah. Joe, what about you? Did this wreck your Halloween?
No, it didn't wreck it. It's not like it made it either. It was just kind of there.
it just Halloweened as Halloween.
Yeah, it was very Halloween.
I feel like this kind of wrecked my Halloween only because I liked the Evil Dead so much, and then I thought, oh, Evil Dead 2, this is going to be fun. And then I watched it, and I didn't really enjoy it.
Did you miss the comedy aspect of what was going on?
I didn't think it was funny. I thought it was, like, not...
Well, no, I agree. I don't think the movie was funny, but they made it obvious that this was more of a comedy.
Oh, I 100% understood what they were going for on it. It's just so, like, I also 100% understand...
Absolutely, I'm with Ashley. So there's two different schools of, like, dark comedy in cinema. There's dark comedy, which is, like, dark ironic comedy, which, like, movies like Death at a Funeral or, like, Death to Smoochie, things like that are in. Shaun of the Dead, right? And then you have something called black
Smoochie
comedy.
Smoochie Boochies.
And black comedy is... black comedy is anything that is incredibly over the top, ridiculous, hyper violent, no seriousness taken into it whatsoever.
Come on, that's funny. That was a funny one.
And that was funny. And this is a pure black comedy film. And most people, when they think of a dark comedy, they think of kind of like a weird amalgam of the two rather than separating them. So if you're able to compartmentalize and separate those two, this is one of the most successful black comedies of all time.
I will say the one thing that I like about this movie is that we got Cabin in the Woods because this movie exists.
100%.
Wait, seriously?
Cabin in the Woods would not exist.
Yeah.
Yeah, because 100%. The whole thing is a commentary on movies like The Evil Dead.
I've never seen Cabin in the Woods, so I don't know.
What?
Oh, Joe! What?
Dude, that's the best movie! You have to see it, Joe. How have you not seen it?
You're not seeing what you don't want to see. Puppeteers.
Puppeteers?
Pop-Tarts? Did you say you have Pop-Tarts?
It's not
how
so can bad.
Wait a minute. Hang on. But... Is this the one with Sean Hunter in it?
Dude, it would have been so much funnier. It would have been so much funnier.
Which one is
this? The one with the cabin in the woods?
There's a Hemsworth in this one.
What's the one that has Sean Hunter in it?
That's called Cabin Fever.
Oh, that's the one I've seen. Haven't seen Cabin in the Woods.
Cabin in the Woods is a great commentary on movies like this. I love that movie. I think it's great. I'm not going to tell Joe anything else about it because I want him to be...
We'll watch it today. It's on
Hulu. Fun with it.
Ah, perfect.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was just about to say, I was like, how the hell are you eating breakfast next to Ashley and you have never seen Cabin in the Woods? Like, that just feels like two things that make no sense.
Breakfast, Ashley, Cabin in the Woods. Makes no sense.
Yeah, it all goes together.
It's mandatory. If you're friends with Ashley, it's mandatory.
If you're eating breakfast with Ashley, you have better have seen Cabin in the Woods.
100%.
Yeah, it's a little iffy. Like, she'll let you slide if you haven't seen Zombievers yet, but, you know, that's the other one on there.
Goodness.
No. So let me tell you guys a little bit about this movie. But before I do, you can go to wreckmypodcast.com and click on our Amazon link to get... Help us out.
Help us out.
March. This came out March 13th, 1987. It had a $3.6 million budget, and it grossed just under $6 million. So I guess it made its money back. It did pretty good. It was filmed in Detroit as well as a studio in North Carolina. No, it was not. It was in a studio, pretty much, that it was filmed. Like, I think the cabin was actually in some type of wooded area, but I think the set of inside was all filmed on a stage.
I'm right next to North Carolina. I wonder if that's, like, a real still go visit.
It was built in the gymnasium of a high school, so I'm pretty sure they tore it down.
It's probably gone, yeah.
Yeah. It was also referred to as Evil Dead 2, Dead by Dawn, which is... A good subtitle for this movie because they say it about 500 times in 30 seconds in one scene.
Too many times. Yeah.
Too many times. So Sam Raimi directed this one just like the whole Evil Dead trilogy, as well as he's going to be directing Doctor Strange in the Multiverse of Madness, which is great because he is a prolific horror director. So I think it'll be kind of fun. I feel like Sam Raimi is to horror films what David Lynch is to other weird David Lynch films.
So
what would his genre be?
Joe, this is 100% Jordan trying to explain auteur theory.
Yes.
Oh yeah, seriously.
I don't know.
Yeah. He's like, everything Sam Raimi's done looks like a Sam Raimi movie.
Yeah.
And you're like, I have a
jingle for this one. It's, oh yes, Jordan tries to explain the auteur movies. Oh yes.
Yeah. And I also like that you made a German guy say auteur.
Yeah, it works. It's great. So this was also written by Sam Raimi, but he had a guy named Scott Spiegel who wrote it with him. I think he was kind of wrote a lot of films because he also wrote, what was that, Crime Wave or whatever that terrible movie was that Sam Raimi came out with, I think. Bruce Campbell is Ash in this, obviously, being Bruce Campbell as can be. We have Cassie Wesley DePave, who was Bobby Joe. And she was a soap actress, which is why I wanted to mention her. She was in a lot of soaps at the time, or that like right after this.
Like Dove?
Yep. Like Dove. Exactly. Craiger joke, Joe joke, all about soap.
She really dialed in her performance.
Oh my God. Yeah.
She really had that thermal. Okay, so
she is her fire.
That's not soap. That's a razor.
Yeah. But I mean, towards the beginning of her first getting there, she really Irish springed into action.
Oh my God. Yes.
Something
okay,
about
anyway, moving
Jurgens
on.
And Jurgens or...
Okay, so Ted Raimi, which is Sam's younger brother, he was the guy in the Henrietta costume, the possessed Henrietta costume. Mm-hmm.
That's awesome.
Yeah, that is pretty cool. And it says here
Get out
that
of
Greg
my fruit
Nicotero,
cellar, darling.
Oh my God. It says here that Greg Nicotero was in charge of the hand, Evil Ed's hand, and the Henrietta long neck Pee Wee head, which I assume is a reference to Pee Wee Herman, but I don't think Pee Wee Herman came out at that time. So
Pee Wee was around.
There was a TV show.
Oh, was he? Oh, yeah. Okay. So the reason I want to mention Greg Nicotero is because that dude is huge when it comes to special effects and makeup, because he was on The Walking Dead and Fear the Walking Dead. Yeah. And he's the one who was in charge of all the zombie stuff on Walking Dead.
He's a prosthetics icon.
Yes, he is. He's got like a million credits of prosthetics he's done. So it's pretty cool. Sam Raimi also played the medieval soldier in this at the end of the movie. Did you notice that?
No.
Yeah, I think that was him because it said here what I was reading was him at the end of the movie.
Oh, that's awesome.
Yeah, and then the composer of this movie was Joseph LaDuca, who also composed Xena Warrior Princess.
Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, and I also wanted to mention the cinematographer. We don't mention cinematographers a lot in this podcast, but Peter Deming, and he was also the cinematographer for Mulholland Drive, speaking of David Lynch, as well as the new Twin Peaks and The New Mutants more recently.
Oh, man. Is that the same guy that plays, that little midget in Game of Thrones?
No, that's Peter Dinklage.
Oh, that's rude. Why would you say Dink in front of his name?
I said, oh, my God.
Wait, I didn't know there was a new Twin Peaks.
The new
season
later?
3.
Wait, what?
Yeah, 2017 it came out.
They
it came out 2017.
Dude, it's so good.
It's so weird.
It's David Lynch. It's weird.
I know.
Well, it's
okay,
also
so
Twin Peaks.
Was it supposed to be set? It was 25 or 27 years in the future.
25 years in the future.
So it was exactly
Wait, don't give too much away because I haven't watched the newest season yet. I've only watched the old stuff.
It doesn't matter how much you give away. It's so weird. It doesn't.
You're right. You're right because all David Lynch films don't make sense.
David Lynch directed Tiger King, right?
They make some sense. Not no sense. They make some.
Thanks, Cam. That's Cameron Molador, professor of film.
Professor of film studies at South College, Knoxville, Tennessee.
There you go. All right, guys. I'm going to explain this movie to you quickly.
Explain it to us.
Oh, yes. It's time for Jordan to explain the movie quickly.
Ash tries to get laid by trespassing, which is not only a felony in 13 states, but also a really bad idea when the cabin you pick is housing the most evilest evil thing of evil ever. The lesson we can all learn from this movie, there's a lot more blood in the human body than you think. There you go.
That's a good lesson. Also, don't read.
The thing is, it's not
never
even
read.
It's not even the book.
Oh, yeah, it's just an audio
recording.
Yeah.
It's the recording.
Don't listen to the audiobook.
Just don't listen to podcasts.
Do not subscribe to Audible. Sorry.
Yeah, it's like you go to Audible's Necromonicon spoken by Michael C. Hall.
Do you think the Book of the Dead is on Audible?
Probably.
Probably
find it.
Oh man, hey Jordan, where can you find speaking of podcasts and where to find things, where could you find Wreck My Podcast merchandise?
Oh, you could find it at redbubble.com/wreckmypodcast or wreckmypodcast/redbubble.com. One of the two, or you could just go to wreckmypodcast.com and click on the Shop Our Merch tab and it'll take you right there and you can get things like our new Wiener Schnitzel shirt.
Yeah.
Endorsed by Krager.
Endorsed by Krager.
Cool. That was smooth. All right, guys.
Let's talk about the plot real quick here. So we start off with Ash taking a girl to an abandoned cabin where she gets possessed by the Book of the Dead, and Ash has to kill her. Pretty much a real quick recap of what happens in the first movie.
I was like, wow, that sounds like the first one.
Yeah, pretty much. Ash then also gets possessed, and this is where the first one ends and the second one begins. Ash gets possessed, but the sun saves him because, the sun saves everything.
I thought it was his dad.
Jordan, did you put that in your notes on your paperwork to sing the...
That came right in
the
head.
I just wish that he had like that phonetically written like on his piece of paper.
I wish so too, but no. Does this mean that Linda could have been saved if he would have just waited till the sun came up instead of killing her?
Yeah, probably, but also if she decided to sharp teeth, no eyes run at me, I'd probably... shovel her head too.
Yeah, I probably would too. You can't get around that. So Ash is now trapped in the house with a demonic spirit, but because he can't get away from the house because there's one bridge that gets you to this house, and that's it, and that's the only way to get out. But yet somehow people are able to get to the house.
There's a trail.
There's a trail that leads in, but not out.
Happy?
I guess
it's no,
part
no,
of the super
it's a happy
natural.
Trail. No, because the demons. It's a happy trail.
It leads in, but not out.
Yeah, but the demons over the middle of the night removed any kind of exit, the same way that they removed the bridge access.
Oh, so it's just like Caltrans back in California on the 5, just overnight, they move ramps around and you can't get off anymore. Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Real question,
it's not the 5, it's the 210 right now. Everything's barricaded.
Oh, okay, 210 right now? It was the 405, then it was the 5, now it's the 210.
The 405 is never going to get finished with construction. That's just not a thing.
Same with the 5 down in right outside of Anaheim. It's never going to be done.
This is exactly why people tune into this podcast, to hear us say numbers that refer to freeways in California.
Yeah. Also, Jordan, have you noticed that no one in our state says the in front of the number?
No, they don't. Mine is I-75 or they do say the when they're referring to the full name. So there's the 121 here is referred to as the Sam Rayburn Tollway.
Yeah.
And the 35 East is referred to as the George Bush Turnpike.
Oh, getting very formal.
And here everyone will just go, get on 40.
Yeah.
And like, get on 41. 41.
That just means you got to buy a 40 before you start your trip.
Sick. Yeah. Yep. And then they'll go like, get on 40. And then you take that all the way to Interstate 11. And I'm just like, can you just say the? It's so much
I'm just
faster.
Throwing out a free reference.
Also, I-11
is late.
Yeah, I-11 would be really hard to find because it would just look like 111.
I know, dude. It's stupid. The South is stupid.
I like how Krager's getting so upset because every joke he wants to make gets made before he can make it. He's just leaving the podcast right now. He walked away. He's so over. So I'll say there was one scene I liked up to this point is the chasing scene in the house. I thought that was a really cool scene.
Oh, that
but then,
whole one shot where they follow
Yeah,
around.
The whole one shot was really cool where he's running around.
I noticed
but
that
then
too.
It ended stupidly because I'm pretty much like, this is Three Stooges. Like, it's so easy to just to fool the evil spirit. Like, how did the evil spirit should know where he is all the time. It doesn't need to visually see him.
Hey, Krager.
That spirit's never been to the house before.
Krager, you got your cheese nips?
I got cookies, Mexican cookies.
Ooh.
He lives in Newhall now, stuff. So.
Yes, he's got this Mexican. So now we get the dancing. Yes, we get the dancing claymation dead lady in the next scene, and she gets chainsawed all up. Then we have where the craziness starts, the hand possession scene, which they obviously sped up. Now, this is a problem
as
I
Joe
had
would
here.
Say, don't knock
they
until you
sped
try
up
it.
A...
Exactly, speeding it up.
The hand possession? So, the speed up scene is used many times through this movie, and it looks awful every time they use it.
So it's stop motion. Artist perspective, the reason why it's sped up. One, stop motion, they may have shot it at like 18 frames per second to make it look choppy and jittery, because that's kind of unsettling. Or if they did do 24 frames per second, they sped it up to make it look even more comical and black comedy, to be like, obviously this is clay. Because none of the clay was used to look realistic. So all it'd be like, oh, look at this. And then it makes it like that comical rapid pace that's similar to like the Benny Hill show. That's like, it's like that.
Well, I'm not even saying the claymation part of it. I'm saying when he's fighting with his hand, like we all do, like, ah, my hand's coming after me.
Oh, that's not how
that
I fight
where
with
his
my
hand keeps. Nope.
That's more keeps... like it, though.
The hand keeps punching him and beating him up, and that is sped up. Okay, we're moving on. So the next part is that Ash cuts off his possessed hand, and it turns into an episode of Tom and Jerry.
Oh, it totally does.
Yeah. Yeah, it's pretty much, yeah.
A timeless classic.
The kids of the cabin owners show up with two other people, and they think Ash killed their parents, so they trap him in the fruit cellar, which we know from the first movie is not a good place to find yourself. So, we find out that the parents unleashed a Kandarian demon into the world, and now this group has to stop it. And the group gets tormented by the spirit, but the pages that the daughter brought with her could stop the spirit, so we see a lot of the group dies. And then Ash gets possessed again and terrorizes whoever's left alive. And then he wills himself out of being possessed by holding a necklace and realizing, oh no, Linda.
Because true love saves all.
There you go. And the sun. Ah, Sequenya. So how did... I have a question. How did the hillbilly stay alive after being stabbed by that giant knife? Like, right in the gut, and then he's like, no, but I'm still alive.
Dude, we live in the South now. These hillbillies are, like, way too resilient.
You're right. They are too resilient. They
don't believe in medicine. They don't believe in science. But somehow they're like, oh, yeah, I got stabbed in the neck, and I just stitched it up by myself. And you're like, okay, man, like, way to go.
Well, it's because they don't have blood anymore. It's just whiskey, Bud Light, and lard.
I was
going
to say whiskey, yeah, Bud Light, and Coca-Cola.
And Mountain Dew.
That too. Yes. So Ash
dude,
has
Joe,
to go back.
Joe, I you not. I got a... Sorry, that's two cusses from me that you have
how
to find.
Dare you, Mark. How dare you?
I got an Uber back because I had to get... I had to get four tires yesterday. My Uber driver that took me there had a 2 liter of Mountain Dew that he was drinking while he was driving. And... A full 2 liter. And then I kind of like peeked and I was like, I gotta know. And I looked in the front seat, empty 2 liter of Mountain Dew. So like, I was just like, this guy just drank 4 liters of Mountain Dew today. Like, this is ridiculous.
That's so much Mountain Dew.
It's so much.
It's not economical.
When was the last time you had a Mountain Dew?
Lyft driver? Because that is way too much liquid. You're going to have to pee so many times. I would know.
Yeah. Yeah, Craig.
No, you finish one bottle and then you pee into the empty bottle while you're drinking the other bottle.
Oh, maybe he was just drinking his pee from like 6 hours ago.
I mean, that's just Mountain Dew.
And back to Joe's question. Right. Last time I had a Mountain Dew, I don't know, like 6 years ago. Like, I can't remember.
I went to Taco Bell the other week and had a Baja
Wreck
Blast.
My taste buds.
So.
Oh, nice.
Ooh, yeah, Baja Blast.
Anyone try the Dew-a-Rita?
What's a
Dew-a-Rita?
It's the Mountain Dew margarita that's now being sold at Red Lobster's.
Yep.
That's so gross.
Exactly.
Who still
exactly.
goes to Red Lobster, though?
No one.
Those biscuits, though. Those biscuits, though.
You have Chelsea now.
And so I want some scrimp.
Thanks, Bex.
Those, give me a scrimp.
All those rural towns, All the rural towns in the southern states where the Red Lobster is the fanciest place in their town, that's who goes to Red Lobster.
The Red Lobster and the Black Lobster, Angus.
Not an Outback?
What about
Angus?
Oh,
the Outback. That's what it is.
The Outback, where you get good old Fosters. Okay, let's finish this movie real quick here. Ash has to go back into the cellar with the deadite to get the pages so they can stop the spirit. This is where we get chainsaw hand, sawed-off shotgun, which I believe he calls a boomstick in the next
this
movie.
This is my boomstick in the Army of Darkness, yeah.
And this is where he goes groovy, which is also another catchphrase of his as things go on. So he goes in, he gets the pages. And here, I had a problem with this. They get the pages, he hands them up to her, and then the whole time they're just wasting time. Instead of saying the spell and getting everything done, they're like, hey, let's just not do what we're supposed to do and waste time.
This is my major caveat with anyone that watches a horror movie ever, right? Like, everyone's like, oh, you shouldn't do that. Oh, why'd it take so long? It's like, it's a fucking movie, and you're supposed to watch it.
Don't go in the closet.
Yeah, and you're like, oh no, it's supposed to infuriate you.
Don't tell Cam not to go in the closet.
Hey, I've been out for a long time.
he can be R. Kelly anytime he wants.
I will never be R. Kelly. I have never pissed on a child. And I just think with a horror movie, the whole part of the you being part of the experience where you're like, no, don't do that. That's stupid. Plays with your rationale and plays with their irrationality. So you're like, no, 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 no. It's bad. And then something bad happens. And you're like, you feel vindicated. You're like, yeah, I'm smart enough. And then something else happens. And you're like, oh, no, yeah, I probably would have died.
Sounds like, Cam, you should make a horror film that the characters actually make rational decisions, but it still doesn't work.
Oh, that'd be really fun. I actually came up with a really cool idea,
well,
Joe, that I want to shoot with you, and we can shoot it.
You make the choices for them.
Yeah.
Joe, I came up with a really good idea that I actually want to shoot with you, and I'll text you later.
Okay. What are we saying, Beggs?
Krager really wants to. Not worth Krager it. Really wants to say
it
something.
It was one of those not worth it. It's fine.
Okay, Cam. I was gonna tell you, Cam. Actually, I've never felt vindicated watching a horror film. I've only ever felt vindicated at the end of Spider-Man 2. Moving on. moving on. So they get the pages, they finally make the spirit a flesh being as a angry orchard tree. It's essentially what it
oh,
is.
Oh, so
it's
that's
a,
where they
it's
got
a really
the name
angry
for this,
tree
cider.
Yeah.
It must be. And they get the demon then sucked into a portal. But Ash also gets sucked in with it, and then we end the movie in the 13th century Monty Python and the Holy Grail. So there we are.
Well, it seems like we're doing
it.
Pretty good about
yeah,
yeah, time.
Ash is there with a shotgun.
We're doing pretty good
Sorry,
about time.
Go
what's up, Krager?
We're doing pretty good with tying in, you know, our last week's episode of Bill and Ted to Ash and the evil Bill and Ted.
Oh, Ash versus the evil Bill and Ted. I like
it. How funny
it.
Would
That's
it
a great
be
crossover.
If like the phone booth shows up like in the background as they're like trying to yeah. figure things out in like the Dark Ages?
That would be awesome.
And like
be
so Bruce good. Campbell's like, this is my boomstick. And they're like, whoa!
And they look down,
these are our boomsticks, man. Yeah, man. Like, it's...
All right, guys, I have some fun facts for you about this movie.
Fun facts.
Fun facts. So they really were trying to avoid getting an X rating for this film, which didn't end up happening. They ended up, the MPAA was going to say this was going to be rated X, so they just released it as unrated.
Wait a minute, what was X about it?
How violent it was.
It's not even that violent.
It's
no
LA.
X.
Well,
no boobs, no
LA.
X.
No,
it's
back LA. Then,
no,
boobs, back then,
no
it
X.
Was.
Back then.
No, I
there
say
boobs,
no vag, no
dead
X.
Boobs.
No,
no erect penis,
no,
no X.
No X.
This is the
no
80s.
Here's the thing.
This is the 80s.
No yeah, it's the 80s. Yeah, everyone had boobs.
Yeah, yeah, no. And everyone had dicks in the 80s.
Now, here's Wait, what I think what? Happened. Here's what I think happened. Is there were a lot of scenes they didn't film. There's a lot of scenes they didn't film that they were going to film, and they cut them to try and get away from that rating. And one of the scenes was that the girl was supposed to be ripped in half by the tree, and that didn't happen. But I think
That's
that the MPAA was a little queasy about this. Yes, it is.
Well, I also heard that Sam. I also heard that Sam Raimi was very regretful of the tree scene in the first one, Evil Dead,
and they redid it in the remake, and it's twice as bad. It's twice as worse in the remake.
With the tree.
Did you say grape?
Yeah, I heard he was regretful.
Aside, her getting ripped apart is worse than her getting sexually assaulted by a tree.
Yeah.
Well, the first one was unrated too. The first one didn't have a rating when it went to theaters.
Oh, really?
By the way, when I said that there's one scene in there that I don't like, it's the tree scene.
I don't like that scene.
Wait, Ashley.
What?
Did they redo the tree rape scene in the remake from 2003?
Yes. And
okay, that's another reason
for it being in 2013, like, it's a good scene, but it's like just as bad and like hard to sit through as the first one was.
Yeah,
I don't want that. Yeah, I don't want that.
Who does?
There's no tentacles. It's just trees.
Yeah,
it's tree roots.
But they look like tentacles.
Release the Kraken.
Tree roots. Like,
can't release his Kraken.
I think it.
I saw that in theaters, and I was like,
Cam's Kraken.
The most unfortunate, like, theater experience, because it was like last minute. We were sat like in the first row, but we had like the reclining chairs. So we were like reclined all the way back, and it was just like you're looking straight up. And I was like, I can't, like, and I had to share a seat because we bought two tickets, but somebody else took my spot. And I was like, I just don't want to be that person. And I was like, so I just sat with somebody, but I was like reclined to where I was laying completely out and like watching up. And I was like, this is the worst thing to sit through right now. And I was like, and then I had to sit through that. And I was like, God, no. Like, I did not enjoy it.
What's worse?
Yeah, that's no good.
What's worse, sitting through that or watching a movie with your parents that has a sex scene in it?
Well, you know what's worse? Watching parents with your parents.
No.
You can't say that. You fell asleep in it.
Yeah. You have no room to argue that.
I've seen enough.
I listened to that, and I was mad at you, Krager.
When are you not mad at me?
So Cam has something very insightful he wants to tell us.
Yeah, for me, I think that any kind of scene that involves, like...
Hey, remember at the beginning of the episode when I said, let's try not to throw quick quips at each other?
I also just love that Krager's going to completely regret what I'm about to say by doing that. I think that entire scenario, like anything that is depicted that is like sexual assault or non-consensual sex or anything like that, and it should be completely abhorrent, right? Like it shouldn't be something that's depicted in cinema. We all know how atrocious it is.
Yeah.
It doesn't need to be visually represented, and it's hyper triggering for so many people, like myself included. Like
something that
myself
should not be in any cinema.
Cam, I have a question for you then, because since you are someone who knows film so well and you studied it and you have your Master of Fine Arts and all that, how do you feel about A Clockwork Orange then? I've never liked that film because of how prevalent it is, and I know people love that movie.
So I think that movie is incredibly well made, minus that scene. The scene is really important, and it ruined a great song for me for the rest of my life. Like, it is... And not even just that, like it representing any kind of malicious attack on a woman that way.
Woman or a man, doesn't matter.
On a man that way too, is something that doesn't even need to be glorified or sensationalized. Because we already know how atrocious it is.
All gratuitous, and I feel like there's easy ways to imply without having to draw attention to it.
Yes, and it's a cheap attack. It's a cheap visual attack.
Which is another reason why I really don't like 13 Reasons Why. Especially when it is a show that was made to appeal to teenagers.
And they romanticize and make suicide appropriate.
we're all laughing while we say this because we're doing something stupid on the video. So audio listeners, we're not laughing about that. Yeah.
Oh, jeez.
Okay, guys. I have some more fun facts for you here. Because it was an unrated movie, the film production company had to actually open another company, the Rosebud Production Company, to just release this film. So Rosebud Production Company was created to just release this film so it wasn't tied to the parent company.
Really? I thought that was a little poop that just snuck out.
What, the Rosebud?
Yeah.
So this movie was pretty much only made because of Stephen King. Stephen King was such a huge fan of the first movie that he was the one who pulled all the strings to get Sam Raimi the financing he needed for this movie.
Could you imagine being a filmmaker and Stephen King is just like, yeah, dude, I believe in you. Do you want $3.5 million? And you're like, well, oh, this,
because the first Evil Dead didn't do great. No. And then the second movie Sam Raimi did was Crime Wave, which flopped. So the studios were like, yeah, this guy, we're not putting any money into this guy.
Yeah. Joe, so can you imagine if Stephen King like saw Static and he was like so blown away. He was like, I'm going to get us $3.5 million for you to make a movie. Like, what kind of honor is that? Like, that's such that would be a significant awesome. Honor.
I would really and love to do Static 80... again, by the way.
Oh, I'm with in you on late, that. Let's do it better.
In late 80s, Stephen King was at his prime, too. Like, he was,
yeah,
like,
that's when he was all his at hits the top were of the out. Mountain. Yeah, he was at the top of the mountain.
And also, you guys are talking about the short horror film you did, right? Static? That, for yeah, people that Static. Don't know. Yeah,
can so we they release did a short that as Patreon film. Content?
Sure.
I'm down. Let's release it. We're doing spooky stuff. Send it to me. I'll release it and we'll do a little like commentary with you guys.
The sound's super mediocre and but the rest of it's pretty good.
Yeah, you worked with what you had. So let's do it. Let's do a Patreon episode
we tried.
On that. Yeah. That sounds
I love
yeah,
it.
That sounds good with me.
We tried and a 16-year-old ran our sound, so that's why it's bad. And then
Well, that'll do it. So another thing is here is that the large demonic head at the end of the film, the like big tree thing, they actually just left it in North Carolina because it was too expensive to ship back to California. So for years they didn't know where it was. It just like disappeared. And they found it later on in a Halloween haunted house attraction in the same town in North Carolina they filmed at. Someone like took it and put it in their haunted mansion attraction.
Is it still there?
I don't know if today it's still there, but it's in a place called Westboro. I'll send you the town, and you can see how close it is to you. Weston Chester, Mister,
like from Mr. D.
Yeah. I'm 30 minutes from the border.
I'm
Tennessee
almost 30.
North Carolina.
Perfect. And Cam's the perfect person. Yes, he is. And Cam is the perfect person to send into a haunted house because he's the only one that won't pee his pants out of us
I'm
in a haunted house.
I'm the worst person to go.
Yeah,
I'm scared.
Jordan was being sarcastic.
I was being sarcastic, people.
I would diarrhea and pee-pee as soon as I went
you
in.
Would diarrhea.
I'm the worst person to go into a haunted house with.
I would.
Actually, why are you so scared? Aren't you supposed to like all the stuff?
No,
she's the worst because she's not scared.
That's exactly what it is. I'm so desensitized from everything that I'm just like, meh.
That's
like,
why. That's the same with me. It's the people that are trying to scare you, they never come after me because I'm never phased. So they go to the people that are around me.
Yep.
Oh, they would smell my fear a mile away. It smells like farts because I get bubble gut when I'm scared.
Bubble gut.
So,
bubble gut.
Oh,
that's
that was that's the joke.
Of,
yeah, that's the joke of the podcast right there. That's the joke of the podcast. So I want to talk about the tool shed scene. Did you guys notice what iconic glove was hanging up
Michael
in the
Jackson.
Tool shed scene?
Freddy Krueger.
Yeah, the infinity gauntlet.
No, it was Freddy Krueger's glove. From Nightmare on Elm Street that was hanging up in there. And the reason that Sam Raimi did it is because who directed Nightmare on Elm Street?
Wes Craven.
Wes Craven,
that's right. Thank you. Couldn't think off the top of my head. Wes Craven had them watching The Evil Dead in a Nightmare on Elm Street. So Sam Raimi was like, cool, I'll put Freddy Krueger's glove up in a scene to do it.
Hey, Cam, the place looks good. You want to give us a tour?
Yeah.
No, I just had to plug my computer in, so I moved it.
If you
Your
want to see a tour,
looks
we'll do it
so
Patreon.
Nice.
Yeah, let's get the
is
tour.
That a kitchen?
It yes, is really nice. We get kitchen. Yeah, we'll do.
Like
I'll do a
kitchen.
Tour on Patreon content. So yeah. If you want to see where I live in Tennessee, jump on patreon.com/wreckmypodcast. Donate even a dollar. Also that, and come on down, and I'll give you a tour of my beautiful apartment. And this apartment's incredible. I love this place.
Hey, question about the movie real quick. Did you guys know why they didn't do a recap at the beginning of the movie and they had to do a kind of a remake for
no idea
for the first movie?
Because everyone in the Everyone in the 80s was addicted to cocaine and forgot.
Because no one saw the first one, so they were like, ooh, what's this new one?
And also because they didn't have the rights to the first one for some reason. So they couldn't use any of the shots from the first one. Yeah. It's always cracks me up when a director doesn't have the rights to his own movie he did to be able to use it in the next movie.
To be honest, I didn't like the whole remaking of the first one in this one.
Well, they had to do it real quick, so they just like kind of cut down the cast and was like, hey, this thing happened.
Though it wasn't really real quick. It was half of the movie.
No, it wasn't. It was like 10 minutes. It was only 10 minutes. It was once Linda dies. Once Linda dies, it's all done.
Yeah, then it's a fresh start.
So the poster for this movie has that skeleton with the eyes, which is funny because this character doesn't show up in this movie, but does show up in Army of Darkness.
Yeah.
Oh,
so it's
really?
Weird. Like, why is that the poster?
It's a, you know, it's just like a little bit of a foreshadowing.
I guess so.
Foreskin shadowing.
Yeah, why not? All right, that's the episode, guys. We did it all. This is probably going to be another mess of an episode, but we shall see.
What? Okay,
this works.
In all honesty, what episode haven't we done that's not a mess?
No, normally it's off the rails. This is just a mess.
It doesn't sound like a mess.
I don't think it's a mess.
It's a bit appropriate.
We'll see. I'm so self-conscious about us doing it remotely now that I literally, like, every time I post an episode, I'm reaching out to all our friends. I'm like, hey, did you think it sounded good? What did you think sound bad? Like, what critiques do you have?
Yeah,
and everyone's it's fine.
That's because you're Woody Allen.
What are you talking about? I can't do a Woody Allen. I'm not even going to try to do Woody
No,
Allen.
You don't have to do a Woody Allen because you are Woody Allen.
Yeah, you don't have to do Woody Allen.
Yeah, I am. You got a friend in me.
God.
You know,
I like
the
how
worst.
Ashley's the only one who got my Toy Story joke.
But also, guys, look, what's the worst is that now that I don't wear glasses anymore, look at my drunk eye.
Wait a minute. You don't wear glasses anymore?
No, dude. I wear contacts.
No one watches your Instagram stories but me, Cam.
I know. Thank you, Jordan. Thank you for supporting. I wear contacts now. I got them. They're really fun to take out every night. It feels good to squeeze
your
eyeball.
That's what she said.
Oh, well, it's a good thing you actually take them out and don't sleep with them in like most people do.
No, I won't because I'm not an idiot.
Yeah, I support Cam so much that I watch his Instagram stories and I go, Madison, look how fucking weird Cam looks.
Yeah!
Bark.
Jordan, that's your own bark. You have to
bark. That's Jordan bark!
I'm going to have to do it anyway, so I might as well have fun with it.
Quick question before we leave, Jordan.
Yeah.
What's a quadruple?
A quadruple is essentially, it's a Belgium-style beer that is, like, it's like a golden ale, but it's done the same way. So, like, you have your triples, and then you have your quadruples, and I think it refers to the amount of malts in it, possibly. I'm not 100%
sure. Oh, so it's not hoppy. It's not like...
I think it's malty.
Quadruple.
Is that an Indominus beer?
I thought it was a quadriplegic who lost their wheelchair.
Yes, a quadruple.
It is Indominus, who is one of my favorite Greek
Rexes.
Oh, Joe
gods.
Got it for
one of your favorite Rexes?
Like 5 seconds earlier.
Yeah.
Because delay.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. All right, guys. So that's the episode. Join us
or don't.
On our Patreon show if you want to see Cam's house. It's only $1 a month. Otherwise, come back next week. I don't know what we're doing next week yet because we still have the finals of our poll up right now. But the finals is Nightmare Before Christmas and Scream.
Can we talk about this real quick? I'm very disappointed with our poll results so far. Everything that I have polled for has lost.
I'm with Joe.
We've had almost 100 people vote on each poll. Like, we've never had this
You're
many
welcome.
People vote on a poll.
Do you mean 100,000 because we're so popular?
100,000. We have 860 followers, 100,000 people voted
and
on
this
poll.
And they're all from Yugoslavia.
A couple.
Yep.
Speaking of, did you see Borat's coming out soon?
Okay, I want to say something. Mm-hmm. I'll wait. Okay, cool. You hear me now. So...
No, go ahead, Craig.
So I was actually really disappointed when I heard this coming out because I love the first one. And I'm like, sequels are never good. And our society is totally different from when that first one came out. Like, it is not going to go well. And so far from the trailer, I think they're going to pull it off and it's going to actually be pretty good. I could be wrong, but so far I'm excited.
Where I'm with Krager is that society is so different compared to when that first one came out in what, 2006, 2007?
Something like that.
And yeah, and but now the fact that Sacha Baron Cohen is releasing it right before the election to show everyone that he messed with, probably on both sides for sure.
Oh, I'm sure.
Right? Like 100%, because that's what he does. And it's going to be a monumental piece of informative comedy that we have never seen in the history of American cinema.
Yeah. I think the...
I heard that Sacha Baron Cohen had a really hard time with this one because he's so well known now.
Yeah, like everyone's going to recognize
Well,
Borat.
If you see...
We're like, in the first one, no one knew what he was.
And that's why he wears all the different disguises.
So if you see in the trailer, he says, like, they play into that in the movie, and they show a couple scenes where people recognize him. It's like, people see me from the first movie, and I'm like, this.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then he wears a million different disguises, and
exactly
1 million.
He's not exaggerating.
I don't know, like, what?
Krager, you should be Borat for Halloween.
It's
Oh, that'd be very nice.
I can do it very nice, but just,
it's very nice.
We must with Pamela.
Let's save all this stupid stuff for the Patreon. Like, let's go.
Yeah. All right, let's close this out here. Guys, if you want to support us, like we said, we have Redbubble, we have Patreon, but also just giving us a rating or a review on iTunes really, really does help us out. So go do that. Thank you guys for being here. I really appreciate you guys jumping on, even Ashley showing up uninvited.
Hey.
Yeah, Ashley.
I mean, you just covered the uninvited, so I feel like it's appropriate.
And in my book, Ashley's always invited.
Yes.
Yeah. And on my screen, she's literally covered.
She
can't
pays
see
enough
her.
Money every month. She can be here.
I just want you all go. To know, all of you to know, that Ashley was my friend first.
That this is true. This is true. Another friend we made at good old Pocock.
Oh, I'm so happy they're opening.
I know. I'm so excited for you guys.
I know. It's just not like you guys can come. Krager, you want to go to Pocock?
Nope.
Yeah, oh, let's yeah. go. We'll send you guys some stuff.
Yeah, me and Cam are just sitting here like fun. All right, guys, thanks for being here. And I didn't change my outro from last week. So remember, two heads are better than one.
What did that have to do with Bill and Ted?
It was because the song "Two Heads Are Better Than One" by Power Tool is plays in the movie.
Oh God, Cam.
All right, bye guys.
Oh, I can. I love you all.
See you later, alligator.
Fruit salad.
I love you.
All right, guys, I'm not going to end this recording. Let's just go into Patreon with it so I don't have weird recording problems going on. We'll
okay, can you guys talk for like...
Okay.
Can you talk for like 30 seconds while I go pee-pee?
Sure.
Okay.
Hold on. I'm gonna clap and you guys are gonna clap when you hear it, okay?
What do you mean? No, wait, count, us, do the one, count two, us down, three, Krager. Okay. Krager, count
you
us
gotta
down.
Count it down.
Clap on four. So 1, 2, 3, 4, and you clap. 1, 2, 3, 4. Yikes.
Cam. Wait, yeah, you know what's funny,
it's
though?
It's pretty bad for
you
Krager.
You counted down, and not even Ashley and I clapped at the same time.
I thought we were going after four, not
no,
on
no.
four.
You clap on four. So let's do this again. Clap
okay.
on four.
1, 2,
Krager,
three,
count us out.
4.
1, 2, 3. See, I do it the same time as Krager. Go to the bathroom, Cam.
It doesn't matter if your feet aren't good. Like, that's what they do.
Can I bring up
McCain.
A point here real quick? We're still recording, which means we were paying to talk about manicures. Can we move on to the Patreon
What is
episode?
Wrong with that? What's wrong with paying talking about manicures?
Yeah, Krager is
so,
like way
on mine? Jordan, you and I do it at the same time. Cam is like less than half a less than a second behind us, and then Krager's a solid 2 to 3 seconds behind.
Yeah, it makes sense
because I figured it out because Jordan is hosting. We're always going to see him at the same time as us, pretty much. I've determined that because my clap is always really close with Jordan's, and so
yeah, I think you're right.
Goes for all the rest of you.
It's okay. Another producer note. Let's try and give each other space to talk.
Now,
if you have a little quip you want to say, keep it in the chamber and ask yourself, is it actually funny? Because if it is, you can say it later.
So are we going to go full cool Donald Trump quip and just talk over each other the entire time?
No, let's not go full Donald Trump.
First debate.
Mm-mm, nope. Let's be a little bit more respectful than our president and possible president.
Do you think he interrupts the doctors when he's in the hospital?
The whole time.
Yeah, of course.
All right.
So I'm gonna bring us into this episode here.
Okay. Bring us into the episode here.
Okay. Wreck my podcast.